Don't put it in my desk. My desk is full.
Is this too close to you here?
You're fine.
I hope. Swinging his arms.
We'll have to adjust. I can
if
pull it
if
all
not,
out.
I can go down there and preach. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a round of applause. I'm going to read to you guys the preparation for worship. Father God, we will trust in your mercy forever and ever. We will praise you forever, and we will wait on your name, for it is good. Holy Spirit, we welcome you here as we worship. Amen.
Amen. To put on my bell bottoms. Ken Bird, would you like to come and open us up in prayer?
Good morning, everyone. I love that song. You know, we read from Psalm 95, the verse 1 reads, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Mm-hmm. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Whoop. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song.
Amen.
For the Lord is great. The Lord is the great God, the King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth and the mountain peaks, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it. And his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Bow your hearts and minds with me, and let's welcome the Lord. Yes. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the promises that you've made. I thank you for our Savior that completes that promise. I ask you to bless each one here today mightily. And I do thank you, Father, in the heaven, that you will. I thank you for the songs of praise. I always thank you for the songs of praise because they sing the words that bless your heart. And that blessing comes back to us in folds that never end. I thank you, God, for everything. Bless our pastors today, our pastor's message, your word, the Spirit's word. May it guide our heart and our minds to seek you more, to read your word, to get to know you more, Father in heaven. For it is a blessing, and as I was speaking with my sister this morning about you, God, your blessings is peace in our lives, and I thank you for all of that. Thank you for all these things, in the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Amen.
This is our call to assembly, as in the early days when they would gather together to assemble for the gathering. I'll be blowing the shofar. Announcements. Don, do you have some announcements? We actually do have a lot of announcements. I don't know if you have, but I have.
Okay. All right, thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Ah, so good to see everybody. So we're going to start off our month this Saturday, August 5th, with a Bunko potluck combination this week. So that'll be a lot of fun. We're going to start at 5 to eat and then go from there. But we're trying to do Bunko, what?
Bobby
every couple of months, yeah. Yes, it was his suggestion. Fruits of Faith will be here. Let's see, I didn't write down the date. 19th, yes, that is a Saturday. Also, it's a barbecue potluck, right? We're going to barbecue, and then please bring your favorite dish, dessert, whatever you like. That'll be a lot of fun. It'll be out in the pavilion, right? Yeah. That last concert we had was so much fun. It really was a lot of fun. And then we have road trip at Chris and Ross's house, and that is on Sunday the 20th at 2 p.m., right after church. Right, Chris? She's looking at me funny, so yeah. Okay. Anyway, so we're going to have a nice end of the summer, I guess, August. So I hope everybody feels like coming and eating, of course, and have fellowship with your brothers and sisters. Oh, I want to remind you guys, please don't eat in the sanctuary. It's just, we'd like to keep it clean and, you know. So I just want to remind you.
No drink.
Oh, yeah, we have bottled water if you need to have a drink. Please let somebody know. We'll be happy to get you a bottle of water. But actually, no coffee or donuts. Yes, thank you. Anything to eat. All right. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Dawn.
Christy, you want to come up?
Morning, everybody.
Morning.
Hey, I just want to remind you that I just looked outside in the foyer, and that clipboard for the volunteers for nursery has not had one sign up yet. So if that is something that you'd like to do, just to volunteer when we have little ones, not often, but we do sometimes, just put your name there so we know who to seek out and ask that morning. Yeah, we can pass it around. It's out there in the foyer on a clipboard. Also, don't forget Family Fun Day. We're gonna have a water slide jumper. Depending on the heat is whether or not we have a lot of games or just a little bit of a game, you know, just something different for the kids. We're also gonna do hamburgers, root beer floats, strawberry lemonade, Capri Suns. We're just gonna have a celebration that the kids are going back to school. They made it through the summer. We made it through the summer. but come on out and enjoy. That's at 1 o'clock on August 12th. So, okay.
Right. Thank you, Christy.
All right, and if you're up and early on a Sunday morning and want to get a good Bible study in, before church, we have a Bible study at 9:30 a.m. in the back of the fellowship hall with Warren Wendell. And on Wednesday night, we have our Bible study. We're going through a small outline before we start the book of Revelations, and we're actually working the outline backwards. So you're getting the good stuff and going to more good stuff. So this next week, we'll be touching base on the rapture of the church, the catching away of the church. And on Friday night, we will be in the book of Isaiah for Avada Fellowship, Isaiah chapter 61. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
All right. I guess that's it. Jimmy, you want to come on up? We're going to wish Jimmy a happy birthday.
Oh.
Come back here, man. Oh, the slide? Yeah. Sorry. I didn't. Hayden, but she's not. She's probably watching.
Hayden and.
Okay. Uh-oh. That's Jimmy's mom, by the way.
Yeah. Wasn't such a good day on 54 years ago.
Oh, and Shirlene Dodge.
Yes.
Oh, Shirlene.
Yeah, Shirlene Dodge. She's not here today.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, everybody. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. May the
All right, well, the ladies or gentlemen who are going to help with the offering, please come forward.
Okay, if you'd bow your heads with me for a moment. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and thank you for this wonderful day you brought us. And we just give you so many thanks that we're able to share all the bounty that you have given us. We are able to give some back to you to the furtherance of your word, Lord. We just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
The song I get to sing for you today was written in 1945 by Pastor Clavant Derricks, "When God Dips His Love in My Heart." Now, this was inspired by Romans chapter 5, verse 5, that says, "God's love has been poured into the hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us." It's been recorded over the years by Alison Krauss, Red Foley, and Tennessee Ernie Ford, just to name a few. It was recorded together with Elvis Presley, Jerry Lee Lewis, Carl Perkins, and Johnny Cash, all in the same room at Sun Records in the 50s. Hank Williams Sr. recorded this song in 1950, but it wasn't released until 1985. 35 years. I know, I had a friend of mine say 35 years. I can't even believe that. Here we go. When God dips his love. Sang bass, mama sang tenor, Bella's brother and I said, in the sky, Lord, in the sky. I said, in the sky, Lord, in the sky. You guys are great. Thank you much.
Awake. I hope you're awake now. Amen. Chris, will you come and lead us in prayer? And the kids? Let's have the kids come on up.
You're coming up.
You
can come with her if you want.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to see all these faces out there and some new ones I haven't seen before. Will you join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Right? Who needs Pilates?
Who needs
come to church. Jimmy, where'd you go? Oh. Trying to hide or what? Oh, okay. Come on up. Offer a prayer for the sick and needy.
Hello, worship team.
Hello.
Hello, church family. Oh, Boker Tub, yes. Good morning. You know, it's a good thing to see all you guys here today. You know, yesterday, not to start on a bad note, but yesterday there was an accident up here on right in front of the Green Spot liquor store, and I don't know the situation of the man who got hit or the person who hit him or whatever. But it just made me realize that you can be here today and gone tomorrow. And I'm like 4 years old Tuesday, because December 2019, the 19th, in the middle of the night, I died. But, you know, because of your prayer, Pastor George, Gabe, and everybody coming, my mom, everybody being at church, at the hospital. And I really, truly celebrate my birthdays different now. Really, you know, and I got a praise report. I prayed about a month ago about my grass. I know this is kind of mellow, but I prayed about my grass, and I said, I am going to commit to watering it. Lord, let it commit to being green in August, right? My grass is so green right now. You guys, you don't know what I've been through the past 4 years, man, with this grass. But I'm telling you, if you pray, it will be. But, you know, the moral of that little story is that you got to do action.
That's right.
With that prayer, right?
Yep.
I guess it's kind of analogy now, you know what I mean? But, yeah, man, I prayed about the grass, and I had a responsibility in that prayer, and I watered it, and I listened to instruction by the way I watered it. So, you like, when God talks to you, listen to his instruction. And, man, it's green. I'm serious. I've had gophers, squirrels, hawks, everything, pigs in my yard just tearing it up for years, and now it's green. So, but, yeah, you could be here today and gone tomorrow, right? And I just want you guys to know that we need to pray for these people that are not Christians yet, these people that are lost, that don't have a personal relationship with Jesus like we do. It is so awesome to have a relationship with somebody that, hey, I am accountable to that relationship. You know what I mean? I never really knew how to have a relationship, but today I have a good one with my Lord, and we need to pray for those who do not know, and those we're not sure of, because, man, gone today. You could be gone. That's all I could say. But we're here, and we're going to have a wonderful day in church. We're going to lift up some special people. We're going to lift up Angelique. She's been having a rough past week with some illness and some other things going on with her vehicle. She's a lovely sister of our church. We need to lift her up in prayer. Just like, Lord, whatever Angelique's going through, help her today. Give her strength. Give her your strength when she doesn't have strength, you know. And you notice Kenny's not back there, so we need to lift up Kenny. He's not feeling well. We need to lift up our sister, you know, back east, who's having problems with cancer, and other persons that we've been praying about with has liver cancer. And, you know, it's important that, you know, that we talk to each other when we're here on Sunday, so we can know what's going on with each other, so we can pray for each other, so we can celebrate together, right? And when we can't exactly celebrate, but we can be there for one another because we know what's going on, right? And I believe that a church that prays together stays together, because that is a mighty power that God gave us. So if you would bow your heads and your heart. Yes, let's lift up Matt.
And Coco.
Oh, yeah, and my niece has a new little puppy, and it's not doing well. And she's the kind of person that really gets attached quick, so we need to lift her up. All right, dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we are so happy to be here today. We are so grateful for what you have done for us, Lord God. We thank you for the Son, the design of salvation that brings us back to you, the ability to have a personal relationship with our Savior, Lord God. We thank you for having the ability to pray for people like Matt, Angelique, Kenny, other peoples in our congregation that we haven't really mentioned out loud, but we know who they are, and we have the ability to pray for them, Lord God. And we thank you through that prayer that we're going to have action in that prayer, that we're going to use that
prayer life in a positive way, Lord God. That when we do lift somebody up, that we won't just do it out of a frame of mind, but we'll do it with a whole heart, Lord God. We thank you for the many miracles that we've seen already, Lord, that gives us the faith, stronger faith to pray and to see the answers, Lord God. We know you don't answer right away. Sometimes, Lord God, you tell us to wait, and sometimes you tell us no, Lord God. We are ready for any answer that you give us, Lord God, but we know that when we lift up things to you, Lord God, that we have a better chance of seeing the blessing. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. We lift up our government, our troops, our first responders, our firefighters, everybody out there in the world today struggling with heat. Help everybody stay hydrated, Lord God, and thank you for this day. Amen.
Amen.
All right, for those that want to stand, stand. For those that want to sit, sit. Let's praise the Lord.
Thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise.
Sing praise, sing praise.
You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be his name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Pastor George was talking about our good Father, and this song represents his heart, and he is our good, good Father, the Lord.
Undeniable, I can hardly speak. is who you are, is who you are, that I'm loved by you, is who I am, is who I am, is who I am.
Holy name. Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Honestly, he has air conditioning.
The Lord, because he has heard the voice of my supplications. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I will praise him.
Hallelujah.
Morning, everyone. Wow. I'm glad I came back. I was somewhere else in the spirit. I know, me too. I want to keep going and going. Let's give the Lord a round of applause. Amen. And let's thank our worship team. Amen. Thank you, worship team. And don't worry, Monday we're getting that air conditioner recharged. We got three ACs in this building. So one is for the worship team, one is for the sanctuary, and then the other one for the fellowship hall. And unfortunately, this one up here needs to be charged. So that's why they had the fan going. And yeah. Usually when I'm up here, man, my fingertips and my hands are freezing, and I'm like, please turn it down. But so we are in our series of the Book of Psalms. Amen? Amen. What did you learn so far? Ah, caught everybody off guard. Deer in headlights, huh? Well, you'll be surprised, but the Psalms carries a lot of prophecy. A lot of prophecy. The coming king, when he will reign here on earth. The dealing of Israel during the tribulation time. Instructions for us as well as instructions for Israel. You know, you can take these Psalms as for the historical content, and you can also apply them for their prophetic content. But most of all, you can take a personal application to them. And you can read a Psalm 50 times over and over again and always get something new about it. I remember when I did the study of the Psalms, we were going through our transition here at the church, and boy, did I experience the Psalms in a mighty way. Amen? Pull off the lambs here. They're probably hot. Carrying all that wool. Bow your hearts with me. Heavenly Father, we bless you and we thank you so much, Lord, that we live in a country where we can be free to come and worship and fellowship and get together and be able to read your word, your instructions, Lord. We thank you and bless you for that freedom, Lord. And we pray for our brothers and sisters in other countries who do not have that freedom, who are getting persecuted, who are getting killed just to worship you, just to praise you, just to own a Bible being put to death. We pray for their protection, Lord. We pray for your blessing upon them, Lord. Lord, I ask you right now, please remove everything from inside of us that displeases you, Lord, that we may receive the Spirit's message. And we welcome your Ruach HaKodesh, your Holy Spirit, to minister to us, to teach us, to lead us, to guide us, Lord. And what we hear and what we read here today, and help us to retain it, to be able to apply it to our lives, as well as in a loving way, help others to apply it to their lives. Lord, we ask you that you please give us a hunger to want to know you more. Reveal to us the mysteries of your word, Lord. We also pray, Lord, that we would thirst for your word, Lord, that we would thirst for that living water and be filled with that living water, Lord. And when the day comes, Lord, and we are in your presence, that we may stand on the word of God, that we may stand on that glassy sea. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that you bless us with your Holy Spirit. And we ask all this in the precious name of our Lord and our Savior, Yahushua HaMashiach, Jesus our Christ. We bless you, El Elyon, the Most High God, Creator of the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all the host of them. Thank you for choosing us to be children of the Most High God. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Psalm 52. This here is a psalm about when David was betrayed on the historical side.
But on the prophetic side, it's a foreshadowing of the Antichrist and his boastfulness in sin, as the Antichrist will be an atheist and not believe at all in God and make others and deceive others to not believe in God. You know, we've gone through so much prophetic instruction in all these Psalms. We've gone through instructions that are directly towards Israel and how they will be betrayed and how they will be treated. But there are also instructions for those who will be left behind. Because let me tell you something, this word of God isn't going anywhere when we leave. That's why we have those Bibles in those pews. It's not just for you guys to use, but when we're gone, people are going to be looking for them. And that's to equip them in their instructions. So a lot of this is prophetic. A lot of this is, these are the, what in Hebrew called the Tehillim, and it's the hymnals of Israel. But it's also applicable to us, applicable to us. Amen? Verse 1. Why do you boast in evil, O mighty man? The goodness of God endures continually. Your tongue devises destruction like a sharp razor, working deceitfully. God has a divine mercy that endures forever. And this Antichrist, this man of sin, boasts as if God does not exist at all. You see, there's a power in that tongue. And most people who use that tongue in the wrong way hurt. You know, what is, think about the most deadly sin that there is, right? The most deadly sin isn't murder. It isn't adultery. The ones that really hurt most is that gossip, that lying tongue, the evil tongue. Such a small instrument, but yet it does so much damage. We praise our God with our tongue, and we also curse man with our tongue. It's something that can never be tamed. Something we're going to fight with the rest of our lives while we're here on earth. It's really hard to tame that tongue. Proverbs 18:21 says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit." You will reap what you sow, more than you know. Amen? James 3:5 says, "The tongue is a little member and boasts great things." There is a lot of prideful people who boast great things and don't stop about to think how much damage that tongue really does. You know, I was discussing someone earlier who says, well, that's just the character I am. I love being comedic, and that's just me. And if I'm not comedic, people think something's wrong. And I said, there's nothing wrong with that. But like the Word of God tells us, Paul tells us, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put those childish things away. There's a time to have fun and to have sense of humor, but then there's also a time to be reverent. Amen? Verse 3. You love evil more than good, lying rather than speaking righteousness. Some people would rather lie to tell a lie, even when it would be easier to tell the truth. How many of you experienced that with yourselves, or how about with your children? When you tell them, just please tell me the truth, right? It'd be so much more easier when we come clean. We were discussing about fathers this morning in Bible study. And there's nothing more that our Heavenly Father would desire than if we just tell him the truth. So much more. You know, it's so much easier to deal with our enemy than it is to deal with our reality, than to be truthful. John 10:10 talks about the thief, that he
comes to only steal and to kill and to destroy. But Jesus says, I have come that that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. The enemy that we have today is not just Satan himself, but our sinful desires, our fleshly desires, our selfish desires. We tend to lie to ourselves more than anything else. And yet we want to use Satan as a scapegoat. But there's a time coming when we will be raptured up, we will be taken up, caught up in the air, and come back down in the millennial reign, when Satan will be bound down, chained down for 1,000 years, and God will start dealing with that heart. And there will be no one to blame but yourself. God is dealing with the heart. Jeremiah tells us that the heart is more wicked than all and incurable. That is the reason why when you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, he takes out that heart of stone and gives you a heart of flesh, a living heart, a loving heart, a warm heart. Takes away that cold stone heart that you once had, where only you thought of yourself. Let's not lie to ourselves anymore. Let's be truthful with the Lord. And let's not fall for those lies. There are many lies out there, many wrong teachings, many teachings that are having people get in a frenzy looking for this Antichrist. What are you going to look what are you looking for a man that you're not going to even experience when Christ is going to take you away before it even happens? Waste of time. Instead, focus on the man who is sitting on the throne of God. Amen? Even Jesus Christ told the Pharisees themselves in John 8:44, he says, you are of the devil, your father, the father of lies. We have a heavenly Father. Let's choose to follow truth, and let's be open with him. Verse 4, you love devouring words, you deceitful tongue. And God will tolerate, when that time comes during the tribulation, God will tolerate this man of sin for a period of time. For 7 years, this Antichrist will deceive people. He will have a tongue which will devise mischief. Very, very deceiving person, this Antichrist, when he comes. Verse 5, God shall likewise destroy you forever. He is talking to this man of sin. God shall likewise destroy you forever. He shall take you away and pluck you out of your dwelling and uproot you from the land of the living. This is also the same thing that's coming to Satan. If you read in Isaiah chapter 14, verses 9 through 11, that even the dead, the wicked people, those wicked nations that are in Sheol, they're calling out to Lucifer, hey, you who once deceived the nations, we're waiting for you, buddy. You thought you were somebody and now you're not? No. Come and join us now. He's got his time waiting for him too. You see, Satan is an imitator. He imitates. And he will have the false prophet. He will have the Antichrist. And he will be himself, imitating the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And when he asks people to get that mark of the beast, he's imitating the laws of Israel, where they were to bind the law around their hand, and they were to put it on their frontlets. Now, if you know God, and if you know Jesus Christ, you know that is a spiritual sense. It doesn't literally mean to bind the law around your hand or to actually put it on your forehead. It means by the working of your hand, you will work the will of God. By putting it on your front lids, you are putting God first on your life, renewing your mind like the mind of Christ. So anybody taking this mark is not going to be some digital thing like people fool you of. It's going to be a total dedication to this Antichrist, where they are going to be working the will of that Antichrist, and they are going to be putting him in the front of their lives, dedicating their lives to him, and denying the Creator, God. Don't be deceived. It's not that tricky.
It's not that tricky to see who you follow. Amen? Verse 6, the righteous also shall see and fear. These are the remnant, the people who are in the tribulation that still call God their Lord, that still see Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior. They shall see and fear and laugh at him, saying to this Antichrist, here is the man who did not make God his strength, but trusted in the abundance of his riches and strengthened himself. This man of sin, he gloried in his might and not in the Almighty God. And the believing remnant will worship God. But we don't need the Antichrist here today to see the wickedness, to see the fallen nature of people. You know, people are not going to die, are not going to be dying in hell because of their sins. They're going to be in that place because they didn't accept the provision that God made through his Son. It's that easy. Now, are you going to be perfectly changed the moment you accept Christ? I don't think so. It don't work like that. That's just the beginning. It takes a lifetime to mature in the Lord. You see, there's three parts to your salvation. You're not just saved and you have a big party and say, hey, I accepted the Lord and woo-hoo, yeah, I'm excited. No, that's just a small portion that Christ gave his life for. The rest of it is a lifelong journey. Because you were saved, you are being saved, and one day you will be saved. You were saved by justification through Christ, meaning you put your faith in Christ. He paid the price, tetelestai, paid in full. In Hebrew, zeh nigmar, it is finished. He paid the price. Nothing on your part, but by accepting. And he chose you before the foundation of the world. He knew you were going to accept him. And he fights for you. Our God is a God of war. He goes to war for you. And he didn't choose you because you're a neat person. Nothing special about you. He chose you because he loves you. Amen? So you were saved, justified by faith. You are being saved daily, as the Apostle Paul puts it, we die daily. You are being saved daily by sanctification, which is the Holy Spirit working inside of you, helping you to mature to become the image of Christ. And one day, we will be saved, either when you die or when we're taken off this earth, when Christ comes for his church, and you will be glorified with the Lord. Be with him in glory. Amen? It's a lifelong process. Lifelong process. Verse 7. Here is the man who did not make God his strength, but trusted in the abundance of his riches and strengthened himself in his wickedness. Verse 8 says, but I am like a green olive tree. These are the people that have faith. These are the people who rely on God. These are the people who do not believe the deceitful lies, teachings, deceptions. It says, but I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. Romans chapter 11, verse 16 and 17 says that we are grafted into this olive tree. And the Apostle Paul tells us not to boast about when Israel, those branches were cut off and we were grafted in, because those natural branches will be grafted back in again. We are grafted into this whole plan. Israel was chosen, but so are we, because we are grafted into that olive tree. The Bible calls us a wild olive tree. We're wild people, right? And God's got to tame us. And sometimes to tame us, he's got to prune us a little bit. Trials, tribulations, hurt, pain, troubles. He prunes us so that we can produce fruit. If you're going through those trials and tribulations, it is Father filtered. Remember that the Father only allows you to handle what you can handle because he knows you. And he will only allow what you are capable of handling. It is Father filtered. I trust in the mercy of God forever and ever. I will praise you forever because you have done it. And in the presence of your saints, I will wait on your name, for it is good. There is one thing that God holds in more high esteem than anything else, and that is in his word, in his name. A lot of times you hear these prophets, a lot of times you hear these mighty men and women of the Lord say, in your name, or do it because of your name, please honor your name. You ever going through a situation, call upon the name of the Lord and ask him to honor his name and help you through that situation. You know, in Isaiah 40, he says, when you pass through the waters, you will not be drowned. When you go through the fires, you will not be burned. He doesn't say you're going to go around it. He's going to help you through it. Amen? Help you through it and help you mature. God is eternal, merciful. He's your present confidence. He's your mercy that lasts forever. And we are to offer him thanksgiving and pray for our prayers to be answered. Prayer is God's way of allowing you to be involved in what he is doing. That's his way of being generous. It's not about how you start the race, it's about how you finish the race. Amen? You could be a huge prayer warrior in your life, and you could be fighting a battle that most people don't even fight. You may not be able to get out of the house, but if you're a prayer warrior, man, you're pulling the heaviest artillery out and accomplishing so much for God's will. Prayer is our greatest gift. And like I said last week, is prayer your steering wheel or is it your spare tire? Right? And when it goes out, then you start praying, or do you pray before you make the trip? You got to pray it ahead of time. We were taught that. We just prayed it earlier. Right? God's going to establish his kingdom whether we do anything or not. His will is still going to be done, but yet Jesus Christ teaches us to pray, Our Father who art in heaven, holy is your name, blessed are you, your kingdom come, your will be done in our lives on earth as it is in heaven. We don't realize that we pray it ahead of time, and not only that, but Jesus tells us to call him our Father. That's very intimate. Very intimate, very close. Psalm 53. Boy, this fool. This is a foreshadowing of the Antichrist again, for he denies the existence of God. And it's set to what in the Hebrew is called mehilath, and it means sickness and sorrow. It corresponds to a mournful condition of the lost in the days of the Antichrist. Verse 1 says, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Whoa. Are you kidding me? You know, Tess bought me a movie. It's called, It's Genesis History. And it explains Genesis, a documentary. Oh, it's so awesome. It explains, and they go to the Grand Canyon, and they mention all the layers. And he explains all the layers and all the different specimens and testing they've done through each of those levels of different colors of dirt. Each level of dirt has sea creatures, skeleton, fossils inside of each layer. They found fossils of sea creatures all over the world.
But what stuck out the most, because they have biologists, microbiologists, they have scientists, all aiming, all pointing to the creation, pointing to God. But what blew my mind is when this guy talks about the polar caps, right, the Arctic and the North Pole, he's like, these people say that we're in global warming. We're not in global warming. He goes, what it is that the Earth is still recovering from the flood. That ice was developed when the flood happened, and it's still melting. There's no such thing as global warming. Global warming will be at the end of the age when God sets it on fire. That's global warming. Amen? You want to be in the Lord's presence for that one. I know I do. Talk about a barbecue. Right? But creation itself is evidence of God. Man, it takes strong will to deny the Lord. Strong will. Talk about walking blind. It says, they are corrupt and have done abominable iniquity, wickedness. He says, there is none who does good. God looks down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there are any who understand, who seek God. Every one of them has turned aside. They have together become corrupt. There is none who does good. No, not one. Sometimes it feels like that today. Man. But you have to share the love of Christ. You have to be that light to the world. You have to be that representative for Christ. That's what truly means when you don't live for Christ, you don't honor his name, is what it means to having the Lord's name in vain, is when you're not representing him well. You're not living up to that. That's using the God's name in vain. We have to be good ambassadors. You know, he trusted you, those of you who have accepted Jesus Christ, with his Holy Spirit to live inside of you. Do you understand what a blessing that is? I mean, come on. The power of the creator of the universe inside of you? When you pray, you can move mountains. When you pray, you can heal people of their sicknesses, of their cancers. You know how many miracles we've experienced in our Wednesday night Bible study? Of how many healings, how many people receiving homes, how many people getting healed, how many people's lives are turned around. How about my wife and I? Our life turned around. Amen? I ran into my mom's best friend yesterday, and she goes, you know how many years we were praying for you? And here I was in the parking lot passing out flyers to this next concert we're going up, and I'm sharing the Lord, and I'm out there passing flyers out. She goes, man, you're glowing. She goes, answered prayer. Amen? It's a lifetime. It takes a lifetime. I received Christ when I was 17, and I was on fire for the Lord. But things happen in life, you know? I wanted to live life on my own terms. I wanted to live life on my own ways. I wanted to be in the back seat. And yeah, when I first came to this church, I sat in the back seat for years, since 2009. And slowly but surely started making my way up. Came forward, right? Went back again a couple times. It takes a lifetime. It's not easy. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it. Amen? It's a struggle. It's a struggle. Proverbs 18:2 says, a fool has no delight in understanding, but in expressing his own heart. This is a heart condition, not an intellectual condition. It's not something that's in your mind that there is no God, or that, no, God doesn't exist, and no, I'm not going to accept. It's something that your pride has taken over. It's a self thing. And it's a thing that, because you do not want to be held accountable for the way you're living. But all we can do is share the Lord and pray for those people who are lost.
because you're not going to save anybody by your wonderful speech, by your little tracts, by handing them a Bible. You're not going to accomplish anything. In fact, you might even annoy them. The best thing you could do is to use that supernatural power of prayer from the Creator Himself, and that Holy Spirit will press on that heart and convince them and convict them of their sin that they need a Savior. Amen? Amen? You will win more people like that than you will by your own speech. Jesus Christ says, no one comes to the Father unless the Father draws them to me. And He accomplishes that through the power of His Holy Spirit. You have someone on your heart? Pray for them. You love someone? Pray for them. If you hate someone and they're getting on their nerves, pray for them. I tell people at work, don't make me pray for you. It's on now. Don't make me pray for you, because I love you. I may not trust you. I don't hate you. I just don't like your nature. Amen? We are to love the sinner but hate the sin. That's how you win souls, by being loving. And if they won't accept your message, do like Jesus Christ said, dust your feet. There's like 7 million other people who will listen. Amen? And pray for them. Pray for them. Pray for them. Verse 4. Have the workers of iniquity no knowledge? And this may sound pretty graphic, but it says, who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon God. And we read this and we studied this and we went through this a couple weeks back in Psalm 43, that the Antichrist, that Israel will be sold as slaves and eaten as food during the tribulation. You thought the Holocaust was bad. Man, that was child's play. When the tribulation comes, it's going to be bad. Really bad. And not just for Israel, but for those who got left behind, who didn't accept the truth, the free gift of salvation. And He's going to make a covenant. This Antichrist will make a covenant with them. Daniel 9:27 says, then He shall come and make a covenant with them for 1 week, but in the middle of that week, He shall bring an end of sacrifice and of offering, and on the wings of abomination shall be one who makes desolate until the consummation which is determined. In other words, He's going to say, hey, I'm bringing on peace, I'm bringing on provision, I'm bringing on this, do that for me. Worship me as God, and I'll make this covenant with you. And then He breaks His word right in the middle, and all hell breaks loose. Literally. Literally. Verse 5 says, there they are in great fear where there was no fear. Right? The covenant's broken, and people are in fear. For God has scattered the bones of him who encamps against you. You have put them to shame because God has despised them. Verse 6 says, oh, that salvation of Israel would come out of Zion when God brings back the captivity of his people. Let Jacob rejoice and Israel be glad. So let's remember that when the Old Testament is talking about Israel and Jacob, there's two different things that are going on there. Jesus Christ and God renamed a lot of people in the Bible. Went from Abram to Abraham, Sarai to Sarah, Saul to Paul, but he never changes her name backward. The only one he does this to is Jacob, Israel. He renames him Israel, and he refers to him as Jacob when he's walking in the flesh. So he's saying here, let Jacob, the man of flesh, and let him rejoice, and Israel be glad. Jacob, the conniver, right? The God of Jacob. He can even be the God of a conniver. Mercy, a merciful God.
So let's take our focus off of the end times and the Antichrist, and let's focus on the man, Jesus Christ, right? You know, I want to share with you a little that I talk about the rapture, and all of, well, the ones that come regularly know about the millennium, know about overcoming, and have asked so much questions, and we've gone through that. All the promises of overcoming are in the books to the letters of the churches. Revelation, those letters are for you guys. Those promises of the overcomer, the ones that overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil, those are the conditions to reign with Christ. Just because you accept Jesus Christ does not give you a right to reign with him. You got to put some work in. And it's overcoming the world, the flesh, and the devil. But in order to overcome and in order to be in that presence with him, we have to have an immortal body. 1 Corinthians 15 talks about this. And he says, Paul says that we must put on the incorruptible. We must put on immortality. Not everybody is going to die when the rapture happens. Some people will still be alive when it happens. And you'll be changed in the twinkling of an eye. That's fast. That means the amount of time that it takes the light to reflect off your eye. You'll all be changed. And you will be given an immortal, you'll be given an immortal body. This body wasn't meant to go up and down from heaven. As we learned last week, that there will be an area where God himself, Jesus Christ himself, will descend and ascend. We will also descend and ascend. In the Psalms, you discover that. So we don't stop to realize that there's a man sitting on the throne of God. We picture Jesus Christ as living those 33 years here on earth. He died for our sins, and he went up to heaven. You see, Jesus Christ didn't come here to fulfill the purpose of a manger. He came here to fulfill the purpose of the cross, to pay the price of our sins. And I want to share with you this little children's story. It is through a Bible teacher, a pastor named John Corson. John Corson, he's up in Oregon. And he's a pastor and a Bible teacher. And he had a dream once that gives it a good illustration. He says that he had a dream that he was with the Father, the creator of the universe. And in this dream, he's with the Father and they're going through all different types of galaxies and exploring different universes and going everywhere. And then they stop, and they stop at this small little planet. And he says, okay, and he asks the Father, well, why did we stop? Why are we looking at this little planet? And then as he starts looking at this planet, he realizes that it's populated by dogs. And they're not just normal dogs, they're ferocious, scraggly dogs, vicious dogs. And John says, well, okay, what's up with this planet? Father, what's going on? Why we stop here? And the Father tells John, John, you see that planet right there? You see those dogs? I happen to love those dogs. And there's something I want you to do for me, John. I want you to go down there to that planet, and I want you to share that message. John says, well, okay, you're the Father. Hey, I'll do as you ask. And the Father tells John, John, now in order for you to go down there and share this message, you got to become a dog. John says, well, okay. He goes, and not just you got to become a dog, but you got to become a chihuahua. And John, I want you to know, John, that when you go down there, they are not going to receive that message. In fact, John, they are going to tear you to pieces. But John, don't worry, John. Do not fear. I am going to resurrect you. Now, John, there's one thing, John, that when I resurrect you, you're going to have to remain a dog forever.
You see, we don't stop to think about our Lord and Savior. And as you start beginning to mature in the Lord and maturing in your word, you start to see that Jesus Christ will remain a man forever. We don't stop to realize that there is a man on the throne of God today, this morning. We think of God coming down, one of the greatest miracles is God coming down in the form of a man and paying the price for our sins. But the even greater miracle is that there is a man sitting on the throne of God of the Father today. And he's not just sitting there being happy and smiling. He is sitting there going to war for you. He is interceding for you daily. Amen? As our high priest. And we're going to have a baptism today. And we know that Jesus Christ is our high priest. Amen? And baptism, yes, it's an outward expression of an inward conversion. And it's something we do in obedience. But why did Jesus get baptized if he was already sinless? Fulfill all righteousness. You see, in the Old Testament times, did you turn it off? Oh. In the Old Testament times, when Aaron and his sons in the priesthood, before they could enter the tabernacle and start serving the Lord in the temple, they had to immerse in what we have here in front of us. Theirs was called a mikvah. We call ours a baptismal pool. And before they immersed in that, they were just like any other Hebrew. But it took the immersing to immerse themselves in that pool to cleanse themselves and to serve in the temple as a priest. Jesus Christ fulfilled that by being our high priest and immersing himself that he could serve in the temple not made with hands as our high priest. And if you read in Peter, when he tells us you are a holy generation, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, you're fulfilling your priesthood, when you immerse yourself and you're ready for that ministry. Amen? Bow your hearts with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you, we bless you, Lord, for your love, for your mercy, your grace, Lord. We thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for your word, Lord. Help us to be good stewards, Lord. And help us to call upon your Holy Spirit, Lord, to correct us when we are wrong, to keep us on that straight and narrow path, to help us, Lord. And to bless us with your power, your might, and your strength to accomplish your will, Lord. The greatest adventure in life, Lord, is that we discover your will and allow you to accomplish it through us. We thank you, we bless you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Love one another, pray for, and forgive one another always, and do it. Amen.
So like Pastor Levi said, Jesus is our high priest, and he is a man. And we're going to sing about Jesus' birth. I know it's not Christmas time, but it's the words about Jesus being born and being a man. So join us. It's tell it on the mountain.
You know, every day with Jesus is like Christmas.
That's right.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, or silent
salvation.
Oh, that was fun.
Okay, so we got to move the
Praise the Lord, everybody. If I can have your attention, just a quick second. The Word of God tells us that we must be born again of the water and of the Spirit. So if there's anyone in the house who would like to make arrangement to be born again by the power of the water and be filled with the Spirit of the Holy Spirit, amen? Yes. Let us know, and we're welcome to put you in that water, amen? Yes. All right. Okay, and excuse me, there is baptism request paper out there in the foyer, okay? God put that on my spirit, so I was like shivering like I should go up there. Yes, I like to be obedient. Amen?